Good evening, students. I'm Reena Singh Chauhan. I'll be taking your biology class for your class 9th. So before I begin, I would like you all to introduce yourselves. Be better if you switch on your video, I should be able to see your face. Otherwise, you can just introduce. Tell me your name and the school you're from. I can see some names here. Harshit. Yes, Harshit. Which school are you from?
Sri Chaitanya Technical School.
Okay. Punita Prakash. Hello, Punita. Are you there? Hello, Punita. And there is Ananya Behel. Hello, Ananya.
Hi, ma'am. I'm Ananya and I'm from Ridge Valley.
Okay. I welcome you all, children. Pratyush. Pratyush, are you there? Pratyush Srivastav, you can unmute yourself and then introduce. All right, so today we are going to start with our first chapter, and that is cell. You have been studying this chapter since earlier also. You know, you have a lot of idea about cell, and this is such an important and basic chapter of biology, which is and even in your biology NEET examination there are 4 or 5 questions asked from it. So it's an important chapter. We will understand it, and if any doubt anywhere, you can ask me there itself. Okay, so I'll teach you through my slides. Just going over to So we'll be studying in this to begin with the discovery and history of the cell, the comparative study of unicellular and multicellular organisms, shape, size, and number of cells. Let us see if I can start with the plasma membrane, that is one of the part of the cell, or just an overview of the cell we will do, and probably the structure and function, etc., of the plasma membrane we can do in the next class. I want one of you to define what is cell. Yes, Harshit?
Ma'am, cell is the basic unit of life.
Yes, cell is the basic
Cell is the basic unit of life.
Yes, basic. Let us add to it structural and functional unit of life. Okay, so this cell is a very interesting story here by Robert Hooke. He had prepared a simple microscope, as you can see in the figure also. It was a kind of a convex lens, and through which he saw the very thin, he made very thin slices of a cork, and he looked under the microscope and he found these cork tissue, as you can see in the figure. They were somewhat like small boxes type of things, and he named it as cellula, which is in Latin means a little room. So later on this was named as cell. He mentioned this in 1665 in his book called Micrographia. So this is a very, very important discovery, though what he saw was only the cell wall. he actually saw the dead cells of the plant. So there wasn't any living part of the cell, that is or protoplasm or nucleus or anything, it's just the cell wall. But it was a landmark, because he was the first one who could see something which was completely microscopic and not visible to naked eyes. These are some of the scientists' names which you need to remember and learn it. It is there in your book. I hope everybody has their NCERT book. Puneeta, do you have your NCERT? Ananya? Pratyush?
Yes, ma'am.
No, ma'am, I am not having it.
Okay, you don't have it. So, have you bought it? You haven't bought the book only?
Ma'am, actually, due to lockdown, the book is only available for the schools only. So, ma'am, I'm just using the online one, the PDF one.
Wonderful. That's as good as your the actual book. So any book, any way you can use it, whether it is with you or it is online. So why I'm telling you, because NCERT is the basis. We will be doing certain things beyond book, but most of the things we'll be doing is in the book already, and you will be evaluated. It's very, very important, this thing. So, and whenever I take your class, I would like you to, afterwards you go through those pages and read them once again, understand, and then try to answer the questions. And if any doubt, any problem is there, you can always, in the next class, you can ask about the previous part which we have done. All right. So here, this is important. First, Robert Hooke, who discovered the cell for the first time, and he termed it as cell, you can say. Second was the first living cell was discovered by A.V. Leeuwenhoek. You have to remember this as well. This is given in your books in the yellow box, but nowadays yellow box are also equally important and they are evaluated. You have Robert Brown, who discovered nucleus in 1831. You see, the Robert Hooke discovered the dead cell in 1665, and it was after 9 years, long period, that A.V. Leeuwenhoek then, with a better microscope, discovered free living cells in pond water, some bacteria, etc. Then Robert Brown in 1831, he discovered nucleus. Purkinje, he coined the term protoplasm. Protoplasm was actually discovered by Felix Dujardin. This name is not important because it is not going to be evaluated. It is not usually evaluated. It's not there in your books. But you need to know that the protoplasm term was coined by Purkinje. And you know what is protoplasm. Can somebody tell me what is protoplasm? Puneeta, are you there? Are you with me, Puneeta? Ananya? What is protoplasm?
It's like the cytoplasm.
Okay, cytoplasm, yes.
It's like the fluid substance inside the cell.
Yes, it's a living fluid substance inside the cell. So one part is cytoplasm and another part is in the nucleus, the nucleoplasm. So the fluid part of the nucleus and the rest of the fluid parts all together forms protoplasm. So here we say protoplasm includes cytoplasm plus nucleoplasm. This was protoplasm, the living substance, fluid substance, which is bounded by the outer plasma membrane in all the cells. And the cells have usually inside it the genetic material, which may be enclosed. If it is enclosed, it's the nucleus. So you should be knowing this. Then there was this cell theory, which was proposed by two scientists. They usually ask you the name of the scientist who initially gave the cell theory. It was Amschleiden and T. Schwann. And then what did they find out? Actually, Schlieden was a botanist, so he studied the plant cells. Schwann was zoologist, he studied mostly animal cells. And then they together proposed the cell theory that all cells, whether of plants and animals, they are all made up of cells. All living organisms, all plants and animals are made up of cells. All living organisms are made up of cells. Now here, Rudolf Virchow, another scientist, who later added one more addition to the cell theory, and that was that cells arise from pre-existing cells. When was this electron microscope was discovered? It was in 1940, so late. And then they studied the further cell organelles and all details of the cell. You see, one microscope is shown in your books also on page number 57. It's called compound microscope. You must have seen in your laboratories. You will be studying the structure of this microscope in detail when you will look at the microscope, and you will be knowing all the parts of the microscope. And then you'll be preparing two slides. We will talk about that also. All right. So here, some children ask me, like, what is cork? So usually it is not evaluated, but cork is something which is a part of the bark of the tree. It is a substance which comes from the bark of the tree. It is impervious to water due to the suberin depositions in the cell wall. That is why it is also used as the caps in some of the wine bottles and other alcohol bottles. So though it is not to be evaluated, you should have an idea. The cork is everything which is outside the vascular cambium. You will be studying about the cambiums and the cork in detail under tissue chapter. So let's not discuss the details. Now, cell theory. They usually ask you, two scientists, Schlieden and Schwann, gave this theory, and which was further given an additional point by Virchow. So what was the first point? All living cells are composed of cells. Or you can also say cells are the basic unit of life. And the third one, that all cells arise from the pre-existing cells. So the question usually comes, what are the tenets of cell theory? So tenets, you need not confuse. Tenets means principles. So they are asking you the three principles of cell theory. You can write it in your own words. All living cells are made up of cells. Smallest living unit is cell of any living organism, and the cells come from pre-existing cells. What are living organisms made up of? So we all know living organisms are made up of the smallest living part, which is called cell, because we know that the cells, they group together to make tissues. Tissues group together to make organs. Organs group together to make organ systems, and a group of organ systems form an individual. As we're talking about the complex organisms. But if we look at the very basic level, we know there are organisms which are made up of only one cell. So this justifies that cell is a basic structural and functional unit of life. That one cell can exist independently in the form of unicellular organisms. So here a question usually asked, justify this statement that cells are basic structural and functional unit of life. Then you will write, this is what is given in your NCERT page number 59. The two blue box questions. Second question, why is the cell called structural and functional unit of life? So structural, because it is the smallest unit which can exist independently, and you can give an example of unicellular cell. Functional, because one single cell can perform all the life functions, life processes like nutrition, excretion, reproduction, transportation, respiration, excretion, all the processes can be are done in within one cell. Now, there are the organisms on the basis of number of cells are divided into two types, unicellular organisms and multicellular organisms. So multicellular organisms are made up of 2, 3, 4, or it could be billions and trillions of cells, like in elephants and human beings. Now, if you look at the unicellular organisms, we see that there is a division of labor within the cell. One cell, it is since one cell, if we say in the multicellular organisms, it is at the cellular and tissue level, the division of labor is there. But here the division of labor is there at the within the cell, that is because the cell is made up of a number of cellular organelles, and these organelles are capable of performing certain functions. For example, we know plant cells have chloroplast, and chloroplast is also called, chloroplast is also known as the kitchen of the cell, because it is capable of photosynthesizing and producing organic food from the inorganic substances. So single cell is capable of division of labor at cell organelle level, cell organelle level. Now another cell organelle, can you name some more cell organelles? Pratyush?
Yes, ma'am, like amoeba.
Amoeba is a unicellular organism, okay? But it is a eukaryotic organism, so it has certain cell organelles inside it. Okay, so we know nucleus is there inside the cell, and nucleus is also called the brain of the cell, you can say, which is controlling all the activities of the cell. Between this nucleus and the plasma membrane, the cytoplasm has certain structures which are called cell organelles. I will be doing it
immediately. Yes, ma'am, like rhizosomes, Golgi bodies, etc.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So you have Golgi bodies, you have mitochondria.
Endoplasmic
reticulum. Very good, endoplasmic reticulum, lysosomes. Then in plant cells, it's the chloroplast, as I told you. So mitochondria is also called powerhouse of the cell. So it has a lot of energy which is stored, so that energy can be utilized. Then it has other cell organelles, as you're talking about, Golgi bodies are there, which transport, they package the material and then transport it wherever the material is required. We'll be doing it in detail. So basically you need to remember that there is division of labor in the unicellular organisms at the cell organelle level. And another important point of unicellular organism, single cell, which can produce new organisms by reproduction. And you need to remember some unicellular organisms like amoeba, paramecium. Paramecium is a slipper-like structure of the organism. Chlamydomonas is green in color. It's a single-celled organism which is capable of photosynthesizing, autotrophic in nature. So you can say green cell, plant cells, unicellular plant cell, they ask you, then you need to name Chlamydomonas. Then you have a different types of bacteria which may live singly or live in colonies, in groups. It's round like cocci. Then you have rod shaped, which is bacillus. Then you have these spiral shaped. You have comma like vibrio. So these different shapes of bacteria, which are all unicellular organisms. When we talk about multicellular organisms, I said more than one cell or more than one or two cells, it is multicellular organisms. Multicellular could be simple organisms like Spirogyra, which is made up of a few cells in a filament-like shape, and it is not organized into, it doesn't have any complex organized structure, or you know, tissue level is not, you cannot see it at the tissue level. But then there are bigger organisms, planaria, then you have fungi. Yeah, there's a one fungi shown here, bread mold. It is also known as rhizopus. So this is a multicellular organism, and we have big multicellular organisms like these plants, trees, and elephant, and humans, all multicellular. Now, very evident division of labor in multicellular organisms. This you can write as a point of difference. Division of labor in different body parts. And only germ cells take part in reproduction. So here, multicellular organisms, especially we are talking about the higher organisms, which have certain special cells which take part in reproduction. Whereas in unicellular organism, it is the whole cell which is taking part in the reproduction. So that is another difference you can give. So you have three differences between unicellular and multicellular organisms, very frequently asked. Here you have to remember, examples are not point of differences. Okay. So if they ask you that you, okay, fine, give examples of each of these, then only you will give examples. Otherwise, proper difference points you have to mention. Okay, coming over to the shapes of the cells. So shapes of the cells decide, or they're dependent on, rather, shapes are dependent on the functions those cells are performing. Okay, so unicellular organism like amoeba has an irregular shape, and this shape helps him in forming pseudopodia, and thus it can move around, and it helps in locomotion and also helps in the capture of food material. You have studied this last year. Let us talk about the independent cells which are present in human body, like the white blood cells. White blood cells are also irregularly shaped. So how does that shape helps it? Because these white blood cells, what is the function of white blood cells? Ananya?
Ma'am, they help in keeping the body safe from virus. So they fight the viruses.
Yes, they fight against the disease-causing microorganisms. So they fight against disease-causing microorganisms by different ways. But one thing you can remember, they have irregular shape. They can easily pass out through the capillaries, and they can reach different areas wherein they can engulf the foreign particles. So that is one example you can give if they ask you how the shape of the cells and the functions are interlinked. If you look at the RBC, RBC is said to be biconcave in shape. It has central depression, you can see. So this increases the surface area for its function efficiently to perform its function. What is the function of RBC? Punita? Pratyush? Anybody? Ananya?
And it gives the pigment, like the color, to the cell.
Yes, color. How color is important? What? Why it is red color? Is the pigment? Yes. Which pigment?
Due to hemoglobin.
Yes, your voice is breaking. Say it once again.
It's hemoglobin, right?
Yeah, pigment is hemoglobin. So what is the role of hemoglobin? Hemoglobin actually binds with the oxygen. So RBCs help in the transportation of oxygen from the lungs to the various body cells and tissues. So if it has larger surface area, it will be able to transport more number of oxygen molecules. And you know that RBCs are also mature. RBCs are devoid of nucleus. So that also gives them a larger surface area for the more efficient transportation of oxygen to various cells for the energy for respiration. Then you have sperms, ovum here. You have xylem, phloem, muscle cells. Muscle cells are spindle shaped. Then you have these nerve cells. Nerve cells are also elongated, highly branched. You know which is the longest cell of your body?
Nerve.
Yeah, it's the nerve cell. And which is the largest cell of your body, human body?
Ma'am, I don't know about the human body. Ma'am, actually, that is the ostrich egg.
Very good. Yes, ostrich egg for among all the cells. Yeah, in human body, the ovum is the largest cell in the females. And which is the smallest cell?
Bacteria.
Sperms. Sperms in the male human body are the smallest cells of the body. Okay, so they can, you can give one example of neuron. As you know, its shape is related to the function it performs. What is the function of the neuron? Transferring the messages or nerve impulses from one part of the body to another. So it has to move long ways. So elongated and branched neurons help in the transmission of the nerve impulses. So that way you can give 2-3 examples of how the shape and functions are related. Now here, some of the things, some of these facts are given in your book, which you need to remember. The smallest cell is the cell of bacteria, which is about 0.1 micrometer PPLO, that's a specific bacteria, or up to 0.5 micrometer, the cell size of bacteria could be. The largest cell is the egg of an ostrich, as you rightly said. It is about 17 centimeters to 13 centimeters. So they have different sizes of the cells as well. Now, if you look at the onion peel under the microscope, you will see they look like the bricks placed one above the other. And they have a small nucleus. Very clearly, you can see these are all uninucleated, single nucleus in each cell. So when you will be preparing in your laboratories, you will be preparing the slides. Have you seen it in class 8? Sometimes in laboratory to show you the cells, we show these slides. Has anyone seen these slides in the laboratory?
Yes, ma'am.
So what are the three basic parts of a cell? Three basic parts of a cell. Basic components of a cell. You can see it here. Nucleus, cytoplasm, and plasma membrane. Now plant cells, we know, also have an additional structure outer to the plasma membrane. A protective covering, that is cell wall. Then you prepare the slides of the human cheek cell and you will see these kind of structures. These are animal cells, don't have definite shape, but they are polygonal or somewhat circular in shape. And then they also have the basic three parts, that is the nucleus, cytoplasm, and the plasma membrane. This is when you see under the light microscope, a compound microscope. Okay, so there are certain questions. Let's do from whatever we have done up till now. Why is the cell called structural and functional unit of life? I want one of you to answer, Ananya. Okay, next question. Okay, discoveries you have to write in your notebooks. Would you do you have all the discoveries have you written in your notebooks?
Yeah.
No. So you will be taking the help of the book. I will show you the slide once again. So this is the important scientist whose names you have to mention when you are writing the, you will write Robert Hooke, who first discovered cell, which was the dead cells. A.V. Leeuwenhoek, who first discovered free living cells. Robert Brown, who discovered nucleus. Purkinje, who coined the term protoplasm. Schleiden, Schwann, and Rudolf Virchow gave the cell theory. Here they can ask you which two scientists gave the cell theory, then you will write Schleiden and Schwann. And who later discovered or added one more point to the cell theory, then you can write the name Rudolf Virchow. And then they can ask you what are the three cell theories principle that you can always write. Okay. Give any two points of difference between the following. Unicellular and multicellular organisms. Ananya, what is the first point of difference?
Unicellular organisms have one cell, multicellular have more than one cell, and
more than one cell, absolutely. First point of difference, yes. Another.
Second will be that unicellular organisms, there's only one cell that performs all the functions. And in multicellular, or there are different cells for different functions.
Yeah, so there is division of labor, whereas different cells are performing different types of functions. That way you can write, yes. And one more difference. Though we have, there are only two given.
Ma'am, if the nucleus of single cell organism is removed, then it may die. And if nucleus of multicellular organism is removed, then it may have pain, but it will not die.
Please say it once again. I didn't get you.
If nucleus of unicellular organism is removed, then it may die.
And if the nucleus of the unicellular organism is removed.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
It may die. And if the nucleus of multicellular organism is removed, then it may have pain, but it will not die.
Okay, that cell may die, but then since it is multicellular, so it will not die. Okay. Fine, but it's not a very important point of difference. I want you to tell me a point of difference related to reproduction. Single cell divide itself into two and forms two organisms. One cell divides and forms two organisms. So there is this reproduction is very simple form of reproduction wherein the whole cell divides into two. And then these two further grow and then again divide into four and so on. Whereas in multicellular organisms, especially the complex multicellular organisms, they have specific cells which perform the function of reproduction, which are called germ cells. Germ cells perform the function of reproduction. Like for example, in humans, it is the sperms and the ovum which unite together to form the zygote, and then this zygote gives rise to a multicellular organism. Okay, so that point you can do. Okay, this is a very important question. I think you must have done in class 8th also. Is an elephant cell bigger than the cell of a rat?
Ma'am, it depends on the functions of the cell.
Oh yes, the size and shape of the cell depends upon the function they perform and not on the size of the animal. So this statement is not correct. Give one example that the shape or size of the cell depends upon the function it performs. Give one example. Tell me your name also when you are answering the question. Pratyush, Punita, Ananya.
Ma'am, the nerve cell, it's long and it's elongated and branched, and it's that shape because of its function.
Yes. And what is the function? Transmission of the nerve impulse. Yes. Okay. Explain the term division of labor. This is one thing which is given in your book in quite elaborate way. So let me tell you about this division of labor. First, you tell me what have you understood. I have already discussed this, no? Division of labor. See, in multicellular organism, when we talk about division of labor, then in multicellular organisms, different parts, different body parts perform different functions. So that is division of labor. It's not that the whole body is performing all functions. No, different parts perform different functions. For example, we know there is digestion taking place in the stomach, the digestion and absorption taking place in the small intestine. The heart is beating and it is transporting the blood to all the parts of the plant, all the parts of the body. So that way you have different parts performing different functions. That is called division of labor. But can we say that there is division of labor in a single cell also? Yes. In the single cell, it is at the cell organelle level. Each kind of cell organelle is capable of performing a specific function. Okay. So specific functions that could include making up of the new material or clearing up of the waste material from the cell and so on. Like I have told you, example you can again give. For example, in plant cells, the chloroplast is there, which is able to perform photosynthesis and make organic food. Or there is cell organelle like mitochondria. When you will be doing about cell organelles, you will know more examples and then you can choose your example which one you want to give for this one. Cell organelles. Okay, so here we finish with this first part. Now in the blue box there are two questions given. Second question I have already discussed, and the first question, I mean this is a simple one. I want one of you to read this question, page number 59. Punita, would you like to read this question? Who discovered cells and how? Answer me.
Ma'am, Robert Hooke discovered cells and what? Ma'am, Robert Hooke discovered the cells in a cork, in a part of cork.
Yeah, thin slices. He made thin slices of cork and then where did he see these cells? He saw it under a primitive kind of a microscope, a primitive self-made microscope. We have to mention that. It was he himself who made a primitive kind of a microscope under which he saw the thin slices of the cork, and what he observed, something like small compartments or small little rooms, and he gave them the name cell. So this is what you are going to explain in this. Okay, I have this assignment for you. I want you to write down these questions and attempt them. And simultaneously, we will keep I'll keep discussing these questions as well. So you all have your notebooks with you?
Yes, ma'am.
So let us start. The notes you can write afterwards. The other questions you can write afterwards. You can start straight away with this assignment. And write the first point. A dash is the basic structural and functional unit of all life forms. Can you all show me your video? So you can show me that you have attempted the assignment. Are you all writing? Ananya? Are you writing this assignment? Punita? Pratyush? What happened? You're not interested in writing? Okay, let's discuss then. Who will read the questions? Ananya? Read the question first. Read first question. Are you able to hear me? Yeah, are you able to hear me? Then I want you to read the question. There are other children also. I want you to at least introduce yourself. Sanvi is here. Sanvi Chan.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Have you attended the whole session? Which school are you from, Sanvi?
Ma'am, DAV Shesh Vihar.
Okay. Where is it? Which place?
Shesh Vihar.
Where in Gurgaon only? Which place?
Ma'am, Delhi.
Okay. Then Muskan Pandey.
Yes, ma'am.
Where are you from?
Yes, ma'am.
Muskan, where are you from? Which school?
Ma'am, where are you from? Modern school.
Okay. Would you, Muskan, I would like you to please read these questions.
Ma'am, first question.
Yeah.
A dash is the basic structural and functional unit of all life forms.
Okay, what is the answer?
Ma'am, cell.
Okay. Next question. You only read. Yeah.
Ma'am, a study of structure and composition of cell is called.
Okay, this we did not discuss. What is the study of structure and composition of cell is called? Anyone? It's called cytology. C-Y-T-O-L-O-G-Y. Cytology. Next question.
Ma'am, cell was first observed by Robert Hooke in a dead cock sleeve in the year 1605. He wrote about this in his book.
In his book, what is the name of the book? Micrographia. You can write M-I-C-R-O-G-R-A-P-H-I-A. Micrographia. The word cell was derived, next question, was derived from a Greek word which means a small room. What is this Greek word? C-E-L-L-U-L-A, cellula, Latin word cellula, which means, okay, this is written, the word cell was derived from a Greek, it's not a Greek word, it's a Latin word, cellula, C-E-L-L-U-L-A, which means a small room. First living cell was discovered by whom? Somebody? Sanvi? Who discovered first living cell? Ananya?
Ma'am, Robert Hooke.
Robert Hooke discovered a dead cell. They are asking first living cell. Leeuwenhoek. It's there in your box. Yellow box, Leeuwenhoek. Next time you please read these pages and come prepared. And next class we will do the plasma membrane. So it's better if you read about that as well. Next question. Question number 6, somebody read. Sanvi? Sanvi? Would you like to read the question? Ananya, you read it. Ananya? Okay, I'll read it. Dash is an aggregate of various chemicals such as water, iron, salts, and other organic molecules like proteins, carbohydrates, fats, nucleic acids, vitamins, etc. What could be this? There's a fluid part in the cell. Which is that fluid part in the cell? Ananya?
Cytoplasm.
Okay, and nucleoplasm is also the fluid part. So together it is known as
protoplasm.
Two biologists, Schleiden and Schwann, gave the cell theory, which was later on expanded by whom? Which scientist? Rudolf Virchow. Dash are the exceptions of cell theory. So anything which is not a cell is an exception to cell theory. Which is not a cell? Which is a connecting link between living and non-living organisms?
Viruses.
Yes, very good. Who said this?
Ma'am, Earth.
Who?
Earth, Nagar.
Earth, very good, Earth. Proud of you. Viruses are exceptions to cell theory. Next, dash, cells are primitive and incomplete and have less developed nucleus without nuclear membrane and nucleolus. Which cells are primitive and incomplete and have less developed nucleus? Prokaryotic cells. You'll be studying about prokaryotic cells. Last year you must have read about it. Okay. What is the advantage of multicellularity over unicellularity?
They have many cells to do, so work is distributed.
Very good, wonderful. Absolutely, this is what I was expecting. So multicellular organisms, because they have too many cells, the work is distributed. So very well coordinated and organized way the work can be taken place. And that is because of this division of labor, which is not there in the unicellular organisms. Perfect. This is the answers to first and third question. I would like you to write these questions down in your books or in your notebook somewhere. These are important and frequently they are asked in your any kind of assessment or your test or examination. Anything is not clear, I think this was all very basic. We have already done it, but still certain things which you have come across for the first time. Any part? Children, mute yourselves until and unless you have to speak. Okay, what are the three basic parts of a cell?
The nucleus, cytoplasm, and cell membrane.
Very good. Plasma membrane, nucleus, and cytoplasm. These are the three basic parts which are there in the cell. So, all the cells on the earth have these three parts. How are you going to distinguish the animal cell from a plant cell?
Plant cell is having cell wall.
They have an additional structure which is cell wall outer to the plasma membrane. Okay, what is the difference you know between the plant cell, the cell wall, and the plasma membrane? What difference you know about the cell wall and the plasma membrane? Do you know any difference? Is there? Okay. So, plasma membrane is a living part of the cell, whereas cell wall is a dead part. That is why Robert Hooke saw the cells which were dead cells. Robert Hooke actually saw the dead cells, so he only saw which out of the three components, which component he saw. Not none of these three components he saw. It was the cell wall which was dead. All these three components are living. Plasma membrane is living, cytoplasm is living, and nucleus is said to be living. But the cell wall is non-living. But still, because that was the first time he could see any microscopic structure, it was a very important discovery that he had made. Any question from your side, children? What do you know about the structure of the plasma membrane? So plasma membrane, the most acceptable, you can say the structure is that they have lipids on the two sides which are sandwiching the proteins. Proteins are in the center also, as well as they are present on the surface also. So the cell membrane, plasma membrane is also known as cell membrane, you know. So the cell membrane or the plasma membrane is made up of lipids and proteins. Another very important characteristic of plasma membrane is that they are said to be selectively permeable membrane. So what do you mean by permeability before we talk about the selectively permeable membrane. So these are certain terms related to permeable and impermeable. Permeable is when the things can pass through. So when we talk about a plasma membrane, I mean, what things can pass through? Things could be solutes and solvents which can pass through. So cell wall is permeable because it allows all the solutes and solvents which are in its near vicinity of the cell, they can pass through. But plasma membrane is selectively permeable. It allows only certain molecules to pass through and bans the entry of the other molecules. Semi-permeable membrane is able to pass through only the smaller molecules but not the larger. But selectively permeable, since it is a living membrane, semi-permeable is usually non-living membranes we call semi-permeable. Selectively permeable are the living membranes. They can pass through certain larger molecules as well. That is why it is selectively permeable. It is also known as differentially permeable membrane. Selectively permeable, also known as differentially permeable. So this is an important characteristic of plasma membrane, that it allows the entry and exit of some materials and prevents the entry of some other materials. If you look at the two figures over here, they're showing, the first figure, they're showing small dot-like blue structures, which can be said to be the solvent particles, that is water. And green structures, which are solute particles. Now we know, now this is the membrane they have shown. Now this, through this membrane, whether the solute molecules are able to pass through or they are not able to pass through, or whether the membrane is allowing these solute molecules or the solvent molecules to pass through or not, it depends or decides the semi-permeability or the selective permeability of a membrane. So semi-permeable allows only the solvent molecules. That means it will allow only the solute or the water molecules and not allows the solute particles, or very small solute particles. Whereas selectively permeable selects what is to pass through. It can allow the solvents also easily, and then it allows some solute particles to pass through. And that is why plasma membrane, because it allows certain solute and solvent particles to pass through, it is called selectively permeable membrane. We will continue our session in the next class. Any questions, children, you have, you can ask me. Otherwise, I'm closing this class. So, okay, bye for now. See you in the next class.